25 years ago this week, New Zealand ushered in a brand new political system. First past the post got the boot. Via referendum, Kiwi voters chose the German-inspired mixed member proportional system, MMP. There have been some ups and downs. As Sandra Lee predicted, MMP has meant more Māori in Parliament, more women too. And in an exclusive interview, TVNZ's political editor Jessica Mutch McKay sat down with the Speaker of the House, Trevor Mallard, and began by asking how he felt when MMP began.
I was quite concerned. I was opposed to MMP. I thought it would result in the sort of tail wagging the dog, and I thought the governments couldn't do policy. And now I look at the Parliament and I see a place which looks much more like New Zealand. It's much more representative, gender, ethnicity, sexual orientation. I think it's a better place. We get better debate, we get more informed opinions through having that representative parliament.
The tail has wagged the dog, though. Is that worth it, to have more representation here?
There's been a certain amount of that, but what it means is that they haven't been the wild swings in policy that you might have got in the past. I think if you go through the 70s, the Muldoon times, the Douglas times, you got big changes in policy, all of which went too far. I think having something which is just sort of slows down some of the change and tries to build consensus around it is something which I think is really good.
With the greatest of respect, you've been in politics for long enough to have seen the change from first past the post to MMP. Over that 25 years, what's changed in this place?
Well, I think the people have changed. When I was first here, we had the tail end of the Second World War veterans. It was an old boys, a gentleman's club. It physically worked like it. People smoked in the lobbies. There were big drinking schools and card schools that went on. You know, it was not at all unusual for members to be inebriated in the House. I think there's been, and it's partly gender and it's partly age, and the society has changed. And as a result of that, I think Parliament's become quite a lot more professional.
You talk about it being like a club. There are still really important traditions with Parliament, and obviously the role of Parliament is really important. How do you balance that with bringing Parliament into the modern age, with things like ditching ties and having babies being fed in the debating chamber? How do you balance that out?
Well, I think what you've got to look at is the purpose, and the big purpose, from my point of view, two of them. One is to pass good legislation, and the other is to hold government to account. To do that, you want to have a good range of people in there, and you want them to be comfortable. And if we can do that, then I think the traditions are not quite as important. I think it's really good what used to happen more than happens now is when people come in and they listen to a speech before them and they reply to some of the comments and that, and they listen to the replies that come back from them, where you have a genuine interchange. The thing that I detest is people who read research unit notes. You know, it's not original, they're not putting their own thought into it, and it doesn't add anything to the value of the place. Much better to table the notes and leave than have person after person read them out.
You talked there about being comfortable. Why is that important?
I think for the place to be properly representative, we've got to have people who are relaxed and genuinely saying what they think. And that means, sometimes you've got to leave some of the traditions, but it also means on occasions you've got to be a bit more flexible than some of the parties or than all of the parties appear to be at the moment. And I think there's a tension there. And I think, especially as far as the party's influence on what people say in Parliament, I think that's got worse, not better, over time.
It's tough, though, because, I mean, think about where we're doing this interview. We're in a dark wood-panelled room with lush carpet. If you go into the debating chamber, you can't help feel the weight of history and the people who have spoken there before you. How do you make people feel relaxed who have come off the farm or have come from way down south? How do you do that?
Well, I think part of it is how we do the induction at the beginning when they come in. And I think we've got much better at doing that now than we have. I think that both the last induction and the one before it have been better than any in the past. And I've had a lot of positive comments about it. And part of it, I think we can, you know, we can do from the chair, and we can do as colleagues. We can value what people have to say. We can, you know, make them feel welcome. And, you know, I every now and again send a note to a member saying, you know, that was a point I hadn't heard before. You know, really good that it was expressed. And if we can keep trying to make people feel comfortable and prepared to say things which are a little bit different, then I think the place will be better. I mean, it's not a, you know, it's not an easy place to come into, and as we get a wider range of society here, it's probably even sort of less easy at the beginning. But what we are seeing is that more and more around a Pacific caucus, around ethnic caucuses, people are across the parliament more welcoming within groups. I mean, clearly women have been doing that across the parliament much more in the past 20 years than they did in the 20 years before.
Is Parliament a safe place to work?
I think it's a lot safer than it used to be. I think we've made a lot of progress in the way we contract people to work here.
But is it safe to work here?
I think it is a lot safer, and I don't think you can do an absolute on that yet. It is sort of very much dependent on developing a culture, and I'm not prepared to say that we're ever at the point where I'm totally comfortable with it. You know, we know that when you embark on change, it takes time in order to make that change. But we do have support for people when there's problems. We have a 24-hour line. We have contracting systems which now put much more obligation on the parliamentary service and on members to make sure that they obey the code of conduct.
And with the allegations and the staffer here at Parliament, which have been well canvassed, did you drop the ball in the way you handled that?
I'm restricted legally from making any comment on that, and I'm not going to breach that.
Leaving that there, then, what are the challenges of making Parliament a safe place to work and a culture that people want to work in?
Part of it is with members. Big range of members who come in. You know, we've got a new member who was in charge of a multi-million dollar organisation.
Who's that you're talking about?
Chris Luxon.
Oh, right. Yeah.
And we've got other people who have never supervised anyone in a job at all. And so some people have very different expectations, and I think up until recently we were very, very poor at helping them learn how to do that.
Switching to your role as Speaker, sitting in the big chair, that probably the image that a lot of people are used to seeing with you now, you are Labor through and through, it's running through your veins. Is it possible for you to be neutral?
I work really hard at it. The parallel that I take is when I sort of ref my kids' sport or run the as a touch judge for the Wainui Mata, which I do relatively often. You always try and slightly compensate by favouring the opponents. You know, you give.
Do you think you do that though?
I think I do.
So you think you give National a bit of an easier ride than the government?
I watch the question time again most days, and I quite often make a list of the things that I could have done or maybe even should have done. It is always harder to be in opposition. You know, I've spent far too long there myself, and I know that you often feel hard done by. And we see the complaints. I've seen complaints about every speaker.
Yeah, I mean, in my time, I've seen Margaret Wilson and Lockwood Smith and David Carter, and you, as well as yourself, and you definitely seem to get more than your fair share of complaints. Do you think you have moments where that Labor side comes out for you?
No, I don't.
I know you worked hard at it.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. And there are a lot of complaints, and they are persistent, and I do try and ease off. I think the complaints are basically because sometimes I over-officiate. I mean, I sort of.
Yeah, and I smile.
It's almost like a referee who gets too much into the game, blows too many penalties, rather than let the advantage flow. And when I'm having better times, then generally I'm intervening less. But what that means is I'm allowing more offences to go unstopped. And then quite often when you do that and you actually apply the rules, people get upset.
I mean, do you think you have the right temperament to be Speaker? You had a rep for being a fierce debater and a scrapper. Have you had to tone it down?
Well, of course I've had to tone it down. You change roles. It's like, you know, using the rugby analogy, you know, sort of going from the front row to being a referee. You know, you're out of the, you know, the dark and dirty stuff and into the...
You're still
the,
back at the front row sometimes, though?
Not yet, you know. And, you know, while, you know, you hear a lot of loud complaints, especially on the tiles, I get a lot of much more intensive complaints in this room from my former colleagues. I mean, if you think the National Party think that the most hard done by, I don't think you're right. I think the more intense and sometimes the more accurate complaints come from people from the caucus that I used to be in.
What are you going to do next? You're heading off to be a High Commissioner?
Well I keep on hearing these sort of rumours that I'm about to be sent to
London. So what's true?
London or Washington. Yeah. My wife says that I've probably got the diplomatic skills for the Ross dependency. I've got no current plans to leave. I mean, I know in my time there's never been a Speaker who's done two full terms. You know, I don't have any current plan to retire before the election or even at the election.
You're interested in London or interested in Washington?
I think it's most unlikely that people would consider that I have the diplomatic skills to do that job. I think you've probably highlighted some of it just now.